of course, we discussed, yeah, that I'm going to talk about the cat remedies. But just a little before talking about the cat remedies, you know, I'll just tell you a bit of history of why I realized, I mean, you know, Sachindra and I actually, from, if I look at the 25 years of our practice, the first part was mainly a lot of mineral remedies. And we were giving a whole lot of mineral remedies with good results. Yeah, I won't say that the results were bad at all. In fact, I would say 80% of our practice was minerals. Yeah, and even today, minerals, you can easily note, you can easily, you know, diagnose minerals in a case. Yeah, natural mure hair, this is ferrum fos, this is calcarea salve, aurum, you know, technetium, ferrum. But what started to happen in 2000, this is a personal experience, which is why I'm sharing with all of you. What started to happen around 2007, 2008, was a lot of those cases started coming back. Okay, like they had all done well and everything, then they had gone, you know, then they came back with maybe a new complaint. Somebody was a young boy who was then married, you know, 2001 mein dekha tha, fir 5 saal baad shaadi ho gayi, bachcha ho gaya, you know, somebody was like this. Somebody had lost a father, somebody had lost someone in an accident. You have, no, over a period of 5-6 years, there's a lot of things that happen to us. And this time, when I gave that old mineral remedy, and I could still see the same issues. When I gave that mineral remedy, it didn't work. And that's when I and then in a couple of cases, I started to see very clear loquacity, you know, revenge, competition, very clear animal issues. So then I gave an animal remedy, and to begin with, I was very disappointed. So my I would say my journey with animals started with a lot of disappointment. Because I was thinking, here I am, thinking, you know, there's only one remedy for everyone. This is how we were taught in classical homeopathy. Ki there is one remedy and everybody who practices polypharmacy and everybody who changes remedies is a criminal, whatever, whatever. So I was then somewhere putting myself in that box, you know, that I'm, a, you know, what is happening here? I gave a mineral remedy. I taught that to so many people all across the world. 6 years later, I'm giving an animal remedy. Worst of all, it's working. You know, and the patients are getting better. So it started with a lot of disillusionment and a feeling that, you know, am I doing something wrong here and things like that. And then what happened is I converted that into retrospective study. So I started saying, okay, okay, I have given this patient lactiferinum. This patient was a, you know, let's say calcarea fos before. I have given this patient lactoferinum now, was a magnesium mure before. Let me at least see what is the connection. Why did this patient change to this remedy? Or this patient was an aurum before. Now I've given, you know, tiger or lacleo. You know, so let me see the connection. And then when I saw that, I realized that certain minerals on certain rows of the periodic table that you have on that bookmark correspond to certain mammal or animal remedies. So there was this clear, or spongia, you know, there were some spongia cases which I had given lithium carb or something, which is more the second row of the periodic table, much more higher up. Okay, so I now started to see that the animals that were more developed are more with the heavier metals. And the animals which are lesser developed are more higher. So there are two things that came up in that time of 2007-2008. One is that I realized that there was a connection between animals and minerals. Yeah? Or that you could have a similar classification of animals as you have of the periodic table or the minerals. That was one. And the other thing was that you could have different remedies at different points of time. Are you with me? And the remedies that you have at different points of time do really connect somewhere. So there is some link. It's not that, you know, today you are a spongia, tomorrow you will be aurum. No connection nahi ho sakta, but spongia is way high up and aurum is way down. But if today you are an aurum, maybe 5 years later, 10 years later, you may need a lacleonine. Because that connection, so what is connecting between all of this is there is a common pattern. And whether it's a mineral, whether it's a plant, now some of you might know Jan Scholten's work. who had come to Arika anyway, to, you know, even online if you read some of his work, he works in the same way with the plants. In fact, he was the first one to even give us the minerals. And we were working with animals. So what I realized, and three different people, there's another lady called Mikhaila Yakir, if some of you have heard about her. She also works on plants with the minerals. So then what I realized is three different people in three different parts of the world are working on classifying the three kingdoms in the same way. So obviously there has to be some truth to this matter. And then I was thinking, why is it that the minerals are connecting to the animals? Let's take the mammals specifically, because today we are doing cats, which are also mammals. Last time such an dogs. Now what you see with your mineral remedies generally, let's say magnesium mute. So you see always a dependent side and you see a slight independent side. Yeah, that is what makes a salt in a mineral remedy. There's always one side, and that is what happens in the periodic table. The left hand side elements are very weak. They're very dependent, you know. They are clingy. They want to learn. They want to know. Yeah. Whereas the right hand side elements are much more stronger. Yeah. They are much more independent. They are much more rebellious. Huh? They want to, like chlorine. Huh? The muse, the halogens, iodine. Yeah, they are much more energetic. So there is always this thing. And then there are elements in the center, like say nickelum, ferrum, platinum, argentum, the middle ones, which are more stable. Okay, so there is some pattern here. And so you find a dependence, a stability, and an independence. What is similar to that with the mammals? Mammals are also animals living in groups. Okay, animals are divided. The animal classification is based on, of course, the genetic evolution. Yeah, how stronger, how more evolved an animal is. That's one thing. And then when you look at each group has a specific survival mechanism. Okay? Everyone survives in a specific way. Mammals, their survival strategy is to survive in a group. So they're always together. You always see a herd. You always see a group. Or even if you see independent mammals, you will still see a mother and cubs, which is what happens with the cats. Yeah. So you will see that group or some kind of protection or some kind of being with an adult or being with somebody older gives you the strength to survive, gives you protection. Okay, so there is a dependent side. There is a side that's dependent on the group. But mammals are also very, very intelligent. Yeah? Like, see, insects are also in a group, no? If you see bees, then bees are in large groups, yeah? In millions, thousands of beehives. Is that the bees cannot decide what they have to, the bees cannot decide who will be the queen. There is a leader in the bees as well, like there's a leader in the mammals. But the bees cannot decide who will be the queen. The first bee to break out of the egg, the first one to break out of the pupa, is going to be the queen bee. And the others will be soldiers. And the ones after them will be nurses. And the ones after them will be workers. So that is decided by nature. The bee has no decision making in that. When you look at mammals, it totally depends on how strong each mammal is. So every mammal in a group has the capacity to either be a leader, has the capacity to either be a subordinate, has the capacity to be that in between, you know, chamcha, what we call. So mammals have that intelligence to know or to decide or to work for their capacity, which means mammals have a very strong feeling of identity, that I can be something. So mammals have a dependency on the group, but at the same time mammals also have this thing of I can be independent within the group, or I can have my own stand in this group. And that makes the mammal similar to the mineral, where you see the dependence of the left hand side and you see the independence of the right hand side, or you even see a stability sometimes in the middle. And that's how I started to realize that a lot of my mineral salt cases actually were animal cases. Now, you know, there's another thing. What we have to realize is that in today's world, you know, we see man has also evolved. Yeah, earlier we used to have infections. People died of cholera, people died of typhoid, people died of infections. Slowly then, man started to combat infections. Today, the killers are not infections, but the killers are autoimmune complaints, right? Cancers. Yeah, HIV is an infection, but then what it does is it causes an immunodeficiency. Yeah, and all kinds of various autoimmune diseases. What comes up in children is also allergies, which is nothing but autoimmune. So the focus has shifted from outside, yeah, which is an outside attack, to an inside, which is an inner stress. Now, what do we do with all our patients when they have an autoimmune complaint? They often come and ask us, what is the cause? Mm-hmm. And then we tell them there is no cause. Mm-hmm. The cause is stress, right? Whether it's thyroiditis, whether it's arthritis, yeah, whether it's diabetes, which is a metabolic syndrome, whether it's polycystic ovaries in girls, the only thing we say is change your lifestyle, and most important, change your stress. So what is stress? Stress is within, yeah? And what is the stress usually today is also very animal-like, which is why animal remedies are coming up more predominantly. Because the stress is always, when you see all your patients, the stories are about either the group, or about I am not winning, or about I am not finishing, or about they have so much, I don't have enough, or that one is dominating me. You know, or I cannot have my freedom to do things. Generally, our stories are all revolving around these internal stresses. And the stresses are all about we and the group. Or we and how are we interacting with the group. Or we and how is the group inhibiting us. Huh? Or restricting us in a way. Which is why also I realized that mammal remedies or even bird remedies, at some point we'll also do birds with all, these are so predominant in today's world. You know, that's what I was wondering, that why is it that earlier I had more of minerals, and you know, today everybody is in that jet age, yeah, with the mobiles and with all our connection and communication globally, we are all connected too strongly, but at the same time, we are all way too looking at our own individual space as well. You know, everybody wants their own. See, earlier times, you know, you'll always find parents or grandparents telling you, we used to be in large groups and we had big joint families and we had only a little space and we were still surviving. And look at y'all today, y'all want your own space, y'all want your own phones, your own cars, your own everything. So in a way, we are connected where you can connect to anybody in the world. There is that group. And in a way, we are all fighting for our space. Huh? This is the main stressful point today. Which is why also mammals become a very important point of, a very important remedy for practice. Because of this, and mammals address this issue very beautifully. This issue of wanting to be part of a group and yet feeling that I don't have my independence in the group, or fighting for our independence or our identity in the group. Also, of course, everybody today, you know, the qualities of competition, comparison, vivacity, yeah, all that have become more open. And that is also why I think it was also that in the earlier days there were mammal remedies, but we couldn't see them so clearly. Today we are more vocal about our wants. We are more expressive about our desires. Huh? And that is also the reason why we can spot animal remedies more clearly. I'm sure there were animal remedies earlier as well. In fact, you know, we do this seminar in not in Ranthambore, in the jungles, yeah? So Sachin and I, we do this. Now this year we're going to do it in the Himalayas. I mean next year. Every alternate year we do this. And we do this with the idea to see if even in the villages, so we go right into the jungles, yeah? We went in Rajasthan, we went to Ranthambore. Now this time we are going to this place called Ramnagar. And we go in and we start looking at the local cases there. In the local language. We start looking at them, I mean, we start taking the cases in the local language, and we thought, would it be that there too we would see this? Yeah? And it's so surprising that we see it there as well. And actually, it's much easier there. Because people don't have compensations, no? We have a lot of denial, we have a lot of not showing what we really feel, you know? And whereas there in the villages, they are so open and they are so clear. And the remedies, we had a child with idiopathic thrombocytic purpura, yeah? The child is still with us. And his platelet count was in thousands, you know, like 40,000. A couple of times he was admitted with a platelet count of 20,000, 15,000. The child is now at 2.5 and then finally 4 lakh platelet count. And he's doing very well just on homeopathy, nothing else. And it's a case of lac rhesus, yeah, the monkey. comes from the region of the langurs and the monkeys in Ranthambore. But what's interesting is that even in some small remote village, we could find animal remedies. Yeah? And that's what Hanuman did. When he started proving remedies, he simply took the substances around him and started to potentize them. Yeah? Anything that he knew in folk medicine, or anything that he knew, you know, we have a remedy, Lacerta agilis. That's the green sand lizard, which is a German lizard, and it's been in homeopathy for at least 100 years. It was just a lizard that our homeopath thought, okay, why don't we prove this one? If you're proving animals, if you're proving beetles, yeah, cantharis. Mm-hmm. It's a Spanish fly. No, they thought, okay, if it can sting, then it can also heal. Which is what a snake poisons. No, snake poisons can kill, but we also know that anti-venoms are the world's most potent healers. Yeah. So anything around us can actually really have the capacity to heal us. Which is why, so then why not more and more of mammals? Because they are all around us. In fact, in India, we are seeing a lot more cases of lac loxodonta, which is the elephant. Yeah, because we in India have the lac defloratum, which is the cow. Yeah, now lac loxodonta was not proved earlier. Mm-hmm. Now it is. And now we have a remedy of it. And I have cases of ankylosing spondylitis, which have been very well treated with these kind of remedies. Or lichen planus treated with lac equinum, the horse. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so more and more I'm seeing that autoimmune complaints are having these kind of results with mammal remedies. So we should incorporate and inculcate it more and more in our practice. Coming now to the cats. Okay? Now, we have many remedies, huh? From the cat kingdom. The Gru is Felidae. Okay? And what I've done is, we've now divided cats into three major groups. Okay? One is the domestic cat, yeah, which is lac felinum. And of course, there are various different types of domestic cat, but what we have at the moment is this one, yeah? The Felis silvestris catus, which is the domestic cat. Lac felinum is a much more domesticated, mild, subdued of the cats. Then, there is the next group of wild cats, which are the lynx. Now, there are many others like servals, ocelots, there's a lot in the mammal book. But just to give an idea, the lynx or the wild cats is the second group. And that is, they're bigger than the domestic cats, okay? But they are feral. Feral meaning wild. They have not been domesticated. Yeah? They behave just like our domestic cats, but they are much sharper, much more agile, much more stronger. And then is the third group, and that is the big cats, yeah? What we call as the big cats. You know, you're fascinated by the big cats. No, you always see them in National Geographic and you see all these documentaries. And in the big cats, we have Cheetah, which is the smallest of the big cats. Then the leopard. Yeah, you see a lot of cases of leopard in India. Yeah, the cat, the remedy name is Panthera pardus. It's a cat of our region, huh? Then Panthera onca, the jaguar. And these are all made into remedies, huh? Mm-hmm. So today you have remedies of all these cats. This is a lynx. It's an old one actually. It goes in that other one, yeah? It goes in the lynx family. These are some of... Oops. So there were some more wild cats which we can skip. Serval, snow leopard. Yeah, there's a remedy from the snow leopard. This is again, we are coming to the big cats, yeah? Panthera uncia, puma, then of course the largest, yeah, tiger. Tiger is even larger than the lion. Panthera tigris, and then you have Panthera leo. The tiger has been proved in India, yeah. The lion has been proved, yeah. I think like leo was proved by Dr. Shankaran. Tiger was proved. We were part of the proving as students by a doctor called Dr. Yogesh Vasandi. Tiger urine was proved then, but now we have the blood from the tiger. Panthera pardus, the remedy was available. There wasn't a proving. We proved it in Ranthambore. We did like a proving in our seminar for 15 days. The cheetah has not been proved, but in fact that is one of my very first animal remedies in about 1999-2000. I had to have pardus and then cheetah. Yeah, that was my first case. In fact, that was the first case which got me interested in animals. It was a case where I was giving lycopodium. It was a case of gout. Lycopodium is a very good remedy for gout. Mm-hmm. And the man, I remember, had uric acid levels like 13. Yeah? And of course, he was also on, you know, the medication. Yeah? And he used to have these very severe, extremely severe pains in his ankles. And when he would get that pain, he had to be, obviously, when we are looking at a uric acid of 13, can you imagine the kind of pain it would be? And then he would have to be hospitalized. And what I remember is, and he was a typical, you know, in those days, yeah, I thought lycopodium would fit well. He was a successful personality, yeah, and, you know, he had the typical pot belly kind of a structure because he was traveling, eating a lot, yeah. And a very successful businessman, and he had right-sidedness of complaints, yeah, which is a very typical lycopodium thing. And he had evening to night aggravations, yeah. We know lycopodium is only 4 to 8, but I stretched it to 4 to midnight. You know, I said, chalo, 4 se to shuru hota hai, so no problem, let's start with lycopodium. Gave him lycopodium, nothing more, okay. Then I remember I said, okay, he's somebody who's very strong, very vivacious, very loquacious, very competitive. So I said, maybe lycopodium is not the right one. Lachesis is a good one. Yeah? Very competitive, but lachesis is left-sided. Yeah, hot patient. So I said, okay, maybe I went wrong with my lycopodium. Let's go to lachesis. Gave him lachesis. no result. Okay. And then we redid the case. Yeah. He would always tell me one thing very peculiar. He would tell me, he's a man who loves speed. Okay. So he loves driving the bikes rather than cars. Because bikes, you can always speed, and you know, he would always do this movement. He'd say, you can go and you can swerve and you can go wherever. And then he would tell me, I love the Ferrari, you know, the car Ferrari. And he would always tell me, you know, if I ever have a car, I'll have a Ferrari. Okay? And I thought this, you know, typical ambitious and this, and that. So I thought like a podium. Then I thought of like cases and all of that, nothing more. And then when I read the case, I asked him, what is the pain in the leg like? And you know what he told me? He said, the pain comes in the bloody middle of the night. Yeah? And it grips me. And it grips my foot so much. And within minutes, within seconds, he said, the pain reaches to the point of a heart attack. And the grip kills me. You know? And at that time, I just thought it's an intense pain. Okay, so I'm trying to figure out intense, intolerable pain, right ankle, all of this. But what was even intriguing for me at that point was the way in which he described it. You know, coming in the bloody middle of the night. He would say it's sudden, comes in the bloody middle of the night. Yeah, and then it grips you and then it kills you. Just the way of describing the pain was peculiar. Then as I went into the entire case, you know, I asked him, tell me about your personality and tell me about you as a person. And he's a very, very conscientious person and a very family-loving person. Like, you know, if his wife says that, oh, you know, we don't have this or we don't have this, he will run in the middle of the night to go buy it. Or if his son needs to go swimming and, you know, nobody else is there, he's come tired from his work, he will go to drop his son to the swimming pool. Because he said, you know, when I have a family, I dedicate my time to the family. And he said, it's very important for me to be productive for my family, my wife, my children. And then he told me, the problem is that this pain stops me from traveling. Because when I travel, he said, you know, okay, I asked him, what do you like about traveling? Obviously, it stops you from traveling, yeah, with all this kind of pain. But what do you like about travel so much? And he said, you know, the thing I like about travel is you meet a lot of new people, you upgrade yourself, you know. So I could say he's very ambitious, huh? He said, to me, it's like, it's so exciting, you know. It's like a balloon that's going in the air. You're meeting a lot of different people, this, that. And then suddenly he asked me in the middle of the case, he said, why are you asking me all this? There was another thing that he would do. When I asked him, how's the pain? He would say, you've ever had a heart attack? And I would say, no. See, you should get one. Then you'll realize what the pain is like. I thought, what a way of talking to the doctor. Then I said, I haven't had a heart attack. Acha, hathoda mara kisi ne? Has anyone hammered you? I said, no. I have not received a shock like that. That's the problem, na? Ek hathoda padna chahiye. Then you'll understand what a hammering pain is like. So, and then there is a fracture hua kabhi. I said, no. See, ek haath tod deta hu. Fir malum padega, what is the pain like? He had a very naughty way of talking. You know, very naughty. So even those things were making me feel he's very animal-like. Yeah, in the way he's talking. But then why was Lachesis not helping you? There's competition, there's speed, you know, all of this. Why is Lachesis not helping you? So I was then seeing this is an animal, but this is a different kind of an animal. Maybe I haven't got the animal right. And maybe there is a way to find out. Maybe all animals can be talkative. Maybe all animals can be competitive. But maybe there are some animals which are differently competitive than this one. And then you have this whole family thing, you know. So I thought Lachesis, when you look at it, is a reptile. Yeah. But this man has this, you know, I have to be there for my family. I have to be there for everyone. Maybe he's more family oriented. Could this be another kind of animal? You know, which mammals are. Mammals are very family oriented. So when you have people in your practice who are ambitious, who are strong, but are very duty conscious, they love their family. Yeah? Or it could be family or it could be even people dependent on them. Like they're good leaders. They take care of the people around them. Even then, you can think of mammal remedies. Okay, so there was this. Yeah, and the other thing he said as I was talking to him about it, he said, why are you asking me all this? Why do you need all this for my gout? I said, I'm trying to understand your personality, and the earlier times I've given you something and it has not helped, so I'm trying to find other ways of helping you. He said, listen, you do one thing. Whatever you do, don't take my aggression away. So I said, excuse me. He said, no, my wife keeps telling me that though I'm, you know, he's a loving person, he's very friendly, he goes to parties, he's very social, yeah. He said, in that sense, you know, everything is good. But if I can get angry, or when I'm working, I'm very focused. And then I can get very aggressive. And just as my wife often tells me, you know, reduce this aggression, reduce this aggression. And I hope she hasn't called you up and told you that he's an aggressive man. Because dare you take my aggression away from me. So I could see that, you know, this is somebody who's mammal-like responsible, but also there's so much of aggression. I said, what, tell me about aggression a little bit. What makes you aggressive? And he said, see, there are three kind of people in this world. There are some people who don't work and they don't get anything. There are some people who work, who don't work and still get everything. Yeah? He said, I'm not like that. Those are reptiles. I said, oh, thank you. So he was my first materia medica, you know, in 1999, that time. I was like, this was at that time, I hadn't heard anybody speak like that. And he actually taught me to read materia medica in a different way. You know, he differentiated. He said, those are not reptiles. I mean, those are reptiles and I am not like that. I was like, no wonder my lachesis is not working on this man. Yeah? And in reality, when you see reptile cases, then this is a peculiarity. Reptile cases, reptiles don't take care of their young ones. Reptiles don't build nests. Reptiles don't give milk. Reptiles don't make houses. So reptile cases have to do with how being very calculative, being very manipulative, getting what they want. But mammal cases have to do with I work and I get what I want. So he said, I'm the third kind of people. I run, and you know what he said? He said, I run for my pound of flesh and I get it. Mm-hmm. He had a very nice vocabulary, I would say. So I said, tell me, you run for your pound of flesh and you get it. And now I could actually, you know, this was a case for me at that time, because in my college days, I had not seen materia medica being taught this way. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I had not known that there are remedies from the mammal, like, I know, of course, lacanainum and lacdifloratum, but lacdifloratum is good for headache and lacanainum is good for sore throat. I haven't seen mammal remedies talk like this. And here I could actually learn from this person that actually mammals can even talk about their inner state, you know. A mammal patient can actually talk like a mammal, you know. So then he says, I run for my pound of flesh. So I said, tell me about it. Now he got very defensive. He was like, why are you asking me these questions? Why are you going to all my aggression? I said, no, I'm not going to aggression, just to understand you. And then he said, oh, Billy ke teen bachche rehte. I said, acha, tell me about the three children of the cat. And he says, no, first he said, sher ke teen bachche. Huh? So the lion or the tiger. And then I said, tell me about the tiger's three cubs. And he says, no, if I tell you tiger, you're going to think I'm aggressive. Let me change it to Billy. Because even a Billy has three cubs. Okay, fine. Tell me about the Billy's three children. And he said, you know what? Each child is not going to get his share if he doesn't run for it. And you know what? Just coming to cats specifically. In cats, you have to run independently. Even if you're in a group, yeah, you have to run and make your own. So the competition in cats is more severe, you know, which I learned later. Not with this case I understood everything. At that time I was only into the example that he was giving me. I'll differentiate the dogs from cats in the end. That's when you'll understand what I'm trying to say. But in cats, the mother, though the mother's care, cats are more independent than the dogs or than horses. So in horses, the group is together and everybody's eating and everybody's enjoying. No, that's not the case in cats, because cats are predators. Mm. Yeah. So in a predator, you cannot have everybody come and eat that same flesh. Everybody fights for that flesh. So he was also, I realized, giving me the qualities of a predator. Are you with me?
Yes.
Because in mammals, you have prey category and you have predator category. For example, like equinum or like caninum is more prey category. You know, everybody in a group, I am getting exploited. The prey side often has feelings of exploitation and abuse. But the cat is a predator, however small or big. So they have things like, I am not going to let anyone take what is mine. I am not going to share, or I will give everyone what they deserve. Yeah, they may share, but you share equally or you share fair. Mm-hmm. This is a cat thing. But a cat person is quite independent. He is not going to give in, and you know, he's not going to be this sweet, sweet. Like Sachindra might have told you last time, the dog patients, because they like the group, they will give in. But cats won't. So this man said, though I do for the family and everyone, I am very independent. I don't make my decisions by asking them. I know what I want and I do it. That is another cat feature. Cats make the decision themselves. So when you have patients who make independent decisions, yeah, and this is what I even ask my patients sometimes when I'm making a choice. Say, tell me, how about things? How do you decide on matters? How do you come to discussions? How do you come to decisions? And then they'll tell me, I'm independent, I don't need to ask that, I know it's a cat. Yeah? So coming back to this case, at this point he said, so I am somebody who's independent, I go for my pound of flesh. And at the end of it, he told me, so we were almost there, you know, I could now see he's a mammal, I could see he's a cat very clearly, he even gave me the example of the share and everything. So at that point, I then asked him, you give me a lot of examples of cats, huh? So he said, yeah, I watch them on the National Geographic. So I said, tell me a little about the cats you watch and the cats you like. See, I'll also tell you one thing. At that point, I was gathering my materia medica. Mm-hmm. Yeah? I didn't know enough information. Mm-hmm. And I also wanted to see till what point can I get the patients to give the information and connect me to remedies. Okay? Today, it's very different. Today, I don't even ask all these. Because my information and my materia medica is so clear that with the kind of things people say and the levels I put them in, I know which remedy I want to give. Of course, there are some cases even today who talk like this, but not everyone. But even if they don't, I know where to put them. Okay, so coming back to this patient, I then asked him in the end, I said, tell me about this National Geographic. And he said, the one cat that I do like to watch is the cheetah. So I said, what is it that you like about the cheetah? And he said to me, the cheetah has everything that I have. You know, this was a patient who actually taught me how to do my case taking in future. And then I started teaching everybody, let's do a case taking like this. Today, of course, a lot of people do it like that. Yeah? But in 1999-2000, it was totally new for me and for the people I taught, you know, all our students. Because here was somebody who actually started to connect himself to the cheetah. Today, I now ask people. So I ask four animal questions, out of which one is, can you tell me anything in nature that you can connect to? Yeah, and I tell them, it's not important, don't think about the past, don't think about, because this is not a question that most people have thought about. So I tell people, this is a new thing that I'm asking you. It helps me because images you pick up help me to understand the qualities you like. So I'm looking at qualities, but you pick up images. Are you with me? So people pick up images and that helps me to come to the core of the personality. So this guy, I told him, describe more that you and the cheetah are the same. And then he told me, you know what? My progress in life has been at 70% growth. Whereas everybody else's progress has only been about 20 or 30%. This is the kind of progress I like. It has to be very fast. I cannot take, you know, you cannot go slowly, you know, prodding and looking. That's not my progress. If I want something, I get it. And I get it at that speed. So what I realized that speed is definitely a very important thing. Now it connects to the jokes he was making about the Ferrari. No? And that he likes bikes. And he likes to play badminton as a game where, you know, he says, you have to be so quick that you can't even see the shuttle and you hit it. So that quickness, you know, is so important for him, and that speed and that growth and that growth at that speed. Yeah? Then I also understood this movement, which to me initially looked like lacases, yeah? Like the snake. But when you see the cheetah in the wild, it has to really make that, because the fawn that it's following runs and swerves like this. And sometimes the cheetah, if he's too fast, he cannot even make these movements. But that's very important. And that's why the cheetah's body, when you look at other cats, see, they have such big bodies, yeah? Now you look at the lion, look at the tiger. Yeah? All these are big, bulky bodies. Of course, this is the smaller cats. But look at how stocky the body of the jaguar or the leopard or the lion and tiger are huge. Yeah? They can't run so much. And look at this guy's body. Sleek. Because he has to run. And then after I gave him the remedy, it brought down the uric acid. From 9:13 it came down to 9, then from 9 it came down to 7, then it came down to 6. Within a year, we had come down to the normal count and it stopped those episodes of pain. But that was a case which actually opened me up to case taking. That case taking has to be done in a different way. It opened me up to the whole group of animal remedies. And it also opened me up to the idea that within the animal kingdom, you can have different, all animals can have a similar quality, like all animals can be loquacious, all animals can be competitive, all animals can want to wear bright colors, yeah, all animals can be revengeful, or all animals can feel exploited. This is common. But within that group, the reptiles have a very different way of behaving and taking revenge, let's say, for example. Yeah? It's a very, very manipulated kind of a revenge when you're looking at a reptile remedy like lacases or naja or vipera. Yeah? But if you're looking at a mammal remedy, then the revenge is very straightforward. You do this to me and this is what I get. Like I recently had another case of Panthera onca, yeah, jaguar. And she told me, sitting there straight, you know, absolutely in a very cold way, she said, I like to hit below the belt, you know. So if, you know, she's at a very good position, and she said, if my juniors, if they, you know, take too much of a leave, or if they don't give the work, and if they haven't finished what they have to by the deadlines, then I simply don't promote them. I cut their pay, yeah? And so I hit it where it hurts. But it's very open. I will never hear a snake case talk like this. Because the snakes have a very different way of attacking even in the wild. Now you see, a lot of the behavioral aspects that we see in the human come from the come from the way the animal behaves in the wild. Yeah? And it was actually Kent who first said that we need to prove a lot of mammal remedies. So 100 years ago, Kent actually mentioned, he said the mammal remedies are so close to us, we need to prove them. And we should be having the donkey's milk, the horse's milk, the monkey's milk. It's, in fact, he's mentioned it in Kent's lectures. And it was Roberts. You know, we used to have these philosophy books by Roberts. It was Roberts, H.A. Roberts, who first said that animal remedies, if we do provings, we'll come to know more about the animal's nature, because a human is going to talk in the animal language. And if we know more about the animal in nature, we will be able to treat many humans, which is what they taught. And probably they left it to the future generations to explore. So it was very interesting for me that as it's at school I hadn't read this. You know, in homeopathic school you don't read all of this. You just read the information, the materia medica, you pass your exams and it's done. But when I revisited those books after practice, I thought there's so much here which I had never paid attention to.